As you know, we've been through now about 26 hours, and I've been able to keep a picture of what I've said for 26 hours. And I have news and any notes, but when I get home at night, I begin to feel. I've hurried through something too much, and I've left something out, so I may get up during the night and write down two or three things I thought of in the subject, because at first I started with a very comprehensive statement and left out details, but now I'm getting in where I'm getting more details, and I'm not going to have another run through for more details, so that there are a few things I'm going to mention that are complementary to what we talked about the last time. Number one is the tensegrity, and we were dealing with the, remember, we had the octahedron was made out of three struts, and we found that there was a positive and a negative rotation, three struts of the octahedron, either any one of them could make the octahedron. Then we brought those together. I could make this one a red, this would be a blue, and a blue. You see three that are really nearest you, turbining towards you, and I've got three towards me here. And either one of those will act as a tensegrity by itself. So we bring together two octahedra, and they give us then the 12 vertexes of the icosahedron in the triangulated patterning of the icosahedron. I'm talking about this now because, as I pointed out to you a number of times, octahedron seems to have a double value. When we remember when I used it in the, it occurs in the jitterbug phrase from the completely open here. The first time the octahedron appears, it's already double. There are two octahedra congruent, one with the other. And I showed you in the great circle foldings that I could not make an octahedron out of just three great circles, of which the octahedron seems to consist. It took me two sets of great circles had to be folded to give me the octahedron. So I found that the octahedron is always doubled up, and there is then this double value of the octahedron, positive and negative, either one of which, apparently, you know, I can have three holding up by themselves, the other three can hold up by themselves, yet they come together non-redundantly in the icosahedron, because they are opposite twists, so they really are opposing torque. To me, however, it is amazing how often the octahedron shows up. This, so she seems to have a volume of four, where we find she really is on the hierarchy. Finally, topologically analyzed out, the octahedron is the number two. Tetrahedron is the number one. Octahedron is the number two, and cube is number three. The octahedron is this lower order, but she will always appear to you as double, and you get her in the double form. I just want to keep reminding you something very interesting about that, because then we have the three possible structural systems of the universe, tetrahedron, octahedron, icosahedron, and the limit case is the smallest and the least volume and the most quanta, the tetrahedron, and the icosahedron, the most volume and the least quanta of structure. But they are really singled out, and the octahedron in the middle of the two is sort of doubled, having them both in it. It is a. Also, we have a. Those one or two of you have had crystallography. We get into Iceland spa. I remember, we get the number of times in crystallography, we get double images, these parallel images occurring. Very much as you see the parallel images appearing here. And I also, as we finished last night, after we'd shut down the actual show, I said to people leaving the room that we are really coming to quite clearly to extraordinary, greatest revolution of humanity in the history of man on our planet. I said it could be of two kinds, which were, if power remained really in the saddle, and it became then a power struggle of the arms, a bloody one, then it would really be all over for everybody. If, on the other hand, it is of the mind and a design revolution, where the human mind really uses principles and does begin to participate in the efficiencies we find are operative. We viewed a lot of those yesterday. We really went in for a design revolution. We could then take care of all humanity. This is the antithesis of the bloody one, and all of humanity will come out very well. And so I feel then the experience we're having here in this room together, I'm sure that everybody in this room is born and fairly, we're not all in the same town anymore kind of idea, even though you're young. We're from all over the place, and we're part of a new world man, and we're all you're fairly well up in everything I've said to you. As far as the general information goes, you've been confronted with tetrahedra and anything I've brought before you, you've had brought before you, but an educational system that tended to analyze the experience of what is being brought before us, other than the way I've been doing it with you. I've given you a new kind of a sorting out, because I was looking for nature's own coordinate system. And I was sure she did have such a rational one, and I'm quite confident we have found it. And you're continually going to find it, helping humanity to sort things out. And we're at this moment where, whether we go arms and the power structure revolution, or the mind and the design science revolution, is absolutely touch and go. But that's why I feel it's terribly important that it's happened. And really, you get down to it. Well, Mehdi did a whole lot of work. It is a very interesting matter that the Bell system, for instance, would have video studio like this, with available for research and development of various kinds, of very highest order equipment, and very extraordinarily high order competence of its management, interested in carrying on such a program as this. There have been a great many people expressed desire to have this program developed somewhere where we'd make some kind of a video recording, but it all has happened. It's all come into place. It's come into place at a time of the really we're approaching, and it is a silent kind of a crisis, because we're in a era of humanity, which things that I pointed out to you earlier, reality of humanity up to the 19th century was everything we could see, smell, touch, and hear, and that the reality of now is in that electromagnetic spectrum world where 99.9% of everything that is reality that we're dealing in is invisible and not directly sensible by man's senses. So that what's going on in the way of the revolution is really on, but it is a very silent affair, because this is an accounting affair. It is a thinking affair. It's that people are sorting things out in their own thoughts everywhere. Not just taking yesterday, as you're approaching war, people not to do any thinking. You had your propaganda and get everybody whipping up the flags and then the drums and so forth, and we're going to go out marching to save our side. It's not that kind of side anymore. So that now everybody, as I said, is in on the thinking. It's the first time in the history of man where all of humanity is illiterate, the first time in history all of humanity is aware of all the rest of humanity, very deeply aware. And so that, but the war, the revolution is on, but all of humanity is really thinking and sort of waiting for something to happen. All we know is that the humanity did then either was forced to accept various political leaders, or they in democracy began to elect political leaders. They began to elect a big father to do things for them, instead of leaving it to him. We've gotten to the point where we've discovered that just to get elected in an enormous democracy such as America, that the monies were involved, and to get into that silent, invisible television program and so forth, enormous amounts of sum. The minute money came in, the whole thing became incredibly corrupt. It is inherently corruptible. So that we now have gotten to the point where humanity in general, certainly in the Western world, where there's any democracy, is not having too much confidence fact, almost no confidence in political leaders doing things. They really have going on a really pathetic little show of perfectly sincere human beings who've been historically and traditionally in great power, really not in any power at all. Nothing they're really talking about is of any magnitude of adequacy in relation to what's really going on. I did get into this big picture for you yesterday, so you would realize that, of course, and there is the complexity of playing a game called money, so you'd be able to exchange life support efforts. Well, you're putting in the peas and somebody else is putting in the shoes. You want some way to exchange it. Then we got into the monitor by itself, and then we got into merchants of the money as a medium, and got into playing enormous games with that interest, which I pointed out to you yesterday when we got to where banks are sanctioned to have something called prime rate. All the banks go up to usurious rates, utterly usurious, historically phenomenally usurious rates, where in 10 years, 10% interest, where the bank institution, where people have deposited their money, and the bank is taking the people's money and loaning it out to people, and the bank is making 10% on their money. It only takes 10 years for them to actually take over the credit for the people's money. You've gone from the money representing life support effort of human beings to money representing simply something's manipulated by a game called money. So we have this in its own right, it automatically got into a world exchanging affair, got into a world war, because it was in the metals from everywhere, the technology from everywhere, the knowledge from everywhere around the world suddenly was involved. And with that, then we had that as the money game, finding it very auspicious to escape all laws of all countries to become by coming supranational. And they don't need any passports. The great ideologies don't need passports. They move around anywhere. And the great corporations don't need passports. Well, they become absolutely ultra national. The accountings between the different countries, they have their own offices there. They don't have to go through any states or anything. And just the people have been left national and have to have passports and conscriptable and so forth. People have been locked into a pattern of yesterday, and for the big corporation and big ideology to get on, they have to go supranational. So just here are we little people sitting around, thinking around the world, under great governance of people who big powers that have been assigned and arrived at legally through history as appropriate. Suddenly, these things are not appropriate. And I just want to also point out that great revolutions of history have always, up to now, been waged over the accounting I gave you of the big man coming along saying, this is my land, and everybody say no. And the biggest man, somebody says, win, that's his land. So the power structure could simply have the land. And we have then the revolution for thousands and thousands of years of humanity realizing that the big man owns an enormous amount and he isn't really doing anything but fighting once in a while. He's just a man of arms, and all these people in the peacetime have to keep supporting him in a big way. So we get very easy with 99% of humanity in poverty, because up to the 20th century, less than 1% of humanity was in on the wealth at all, or any security of life. 99% had been in poverty all that time, so the 99% would always be excitable into revolution to try to overcome what seemed to be absolutely unfair condition. So they would like to take over the land. So all the revolutions have always been about the land, and the ownership of the land. As I pointed out to you yesterday, incidentally, on all the books of accounting of our wealth, everything comes back then to what's called real wealth, or real estate. The only real wealth was real estate, was the land. And whoever could get a hold of that land, if it had lucky enough to have gold on it, fine, and lucky enough to have oil on it, but the thing is to own the land. And so we find on the books there's nothing but the physical. And there had to be some chattel mortgage, there had to be some physical, some goods, either land or something very X-rays have been taken out of the land and priced as physical and having weighed that airplane so many pounds of very valuable materials. But the phenomenon know-how, the metaphysical, was not on the books. To some extent, it was there when patents were taken by a corporation, they could seemingly keep the other fellow out. There was some know-how advantage, but very, very small, extraordinarily small. And on the books of account, they're not allowed, they write off the value of that patent right away. It's just good luck that you're making money out of it, but it's not on the books. You cannot put metaphysics on there. So I find that what is going on in the big money, it was really very interesting right here at the University of Pennsylvania this last spring. David Rockefeller came to speak at the Wharton School of Finance. And I went over to hear him speak because he's a friend of mine, and he was late coming, so they asked me to say something in advance. They knew he had to wait half an hour. He missed his train or his plane, whatever it was, getting him. And so they asked me to say something in the interim, and I did. Then David arrived, and we both went to the dinner that followed his talk. And the students were tremendously interested in his reports on both China and Russia, where he had pointed out that he did have, then his Chase National Bank at number one Karl Marx place in Moscow, and he was at the very center of Peking, and the student said, what is it, what are you going to do for the Chinese government? What you're representing, import, exporting, what are you going to import, export? And David's answer was, know-how. Now, I have been in Japan a very great deal in the decades since World War II. And I watched the great companies and the finances of Japan, extraordinarily well-organized people, and they were very visible and clear to me, the way they operate. And they were buying know-how in very big chunks from American corporations. They got going very fast in one business after another, simply literally daring to spend money to buy know-how. This, I think, is possibly the first time in history where there was really became a big commodity. And from this point on, it has been just exactly that. So the military game was a know-how game, and so the Russians would have their officers go in, and the United States would have theirs go into the puppetry wars and train the people. The know-how was always was a trick. So we find the big business suddenly beginning as dealing really in know-how, which is a metaphysical. And I said to you yesterday, very fascinatingly, the game of money, monopoly, trying to escape, and always trying to escape, is always trying to find loopholes and laws, and being a loophole, be transcendental to all the laws by being supernatural. Of course it goes there. Just add to it. That's where the game goes. And so it all then got inadvertently into really just one pocket. And suddenly those who had been the monarchs of the oil lands, who had been very easily flatterable, and the people making enormous money made fantastic amounts of them, so that they just rolled around luxuriated and felt no pain whatsoever. But suddenly, with all the political agitation between the Russian and the United States, who's going to have the oil, suddenly the heads of states began to realize they really were heads of state, and it was the oil. And so it became part of the grand strategy of one side or the other to get the monarchs then to take over, so that the heads of the oil-rich states took over the states and suddenly said, this oil belongs to us. We have then, they did also realize that the incredible amount of know-how the oil company operators, so that there had to be all kinds of deals that went on in there. But we have then suddenly the whole world on what I call a petro-pap, and guns, so everybody's on pipelines, and you just turn on the valve and this thing works. Seemed to be by far, it was the laziest way and the easiest way to get on, and so we had the whole world hooked up that way. And suddenly, here is the flow stopping, and we have these people who then found themselves to be monarchs, really, of incredible wealth, claiming they were, and taking over. And the money got into a huddle of an international cartel, what I'll just call the Honey Money Boys. And so the Honey Money Boys suddenly found that their corporations needed this oil very, very badly. They couldn't get on, the industry couldn't get on without them. And suddenly the monarch simply said, we're going to put the place up like that. And just overnight they took over the money. So suddenly we have an extraordinary condition where the sellers of the vital metabolic supply of humanity also have all the money to buy it. So that nobody has anything to buy with. Absolutely nothing on the books. The world's books are absolutely empty. So we come to a game where this money doesn't work anymore. The fascinating thing is that this has really petered itself completely out. And all everybody's trying to think, all the know-how boys and banks are trying to, how to get this stuff out to get the world using again without really socializing the world. How to keep a game of capitalism and private enterprise and get this thing working. Yeah. It was very easy to get the corporations socialized, but for these corporations to unsocialize and keep things going, it doesn't work very well as a private enterprise. So the great silence that's going on is that nobody can find any way of making this thing work anymore and not do it on physical wealth basis. So that there is a thorough intuitive awareness that the whatever wealth and capability does come, it's going to come from the know-how, from the metaphysical. The physicals are going to be going off the books, and as I said to you yesterday, if you begin getting a world pattern instead of just a local pattern, then you can't take it with you in the next world, and you can't take it with you around the world, so it becomes really onerous. In my own personal experience, it's very typical. I own successively 45 automobiles from the time of my first owning of a car just before World War I. And then I gradually found myself going bigger and bigger patterns. And it's really amazing how just your everyday life, the range that sweep out. These are some great important figures for you. Up to World War I, human beings do average about 1,500 miles per capita per annum with the pedometer show. This is average life. You're to and froing 1,500 miles a year. At the time of World War I, the world and the U.S. were on a basis of 1,500 miles per capita per annum by foot and about 400 miles per capita per annum in the United States by some vehicle other than your own feet. In other words, you were dominantly, threefold dominantly, a vehicle to get around on your own legs. And the mechanization and motorization of World War I, the word of World War I was mobilization. And the mobilization of World War I introduced so much mobility into humanity that after World War I, suddenly those automobiles going and man went up to, excuse me, the walking distance was 1,100 miles per annum, and was 400 on by vehicles that we entered. But right after World War I, by 1918, so much motor equipment got going that man suddenly, in the United States, we're going 1,500 miles per annum by vehicles and only 1,100 miles on his feet. He still keeps on walking exactly the same distance, whether he sits in a chair in his porch or he sits in a chair in his car and he gets out and goes into the kitchen or he gets out and goes into the store. He uses his legs just about the same amount. So I found that from there on, within a very few years, in the 20s, we got up where the average housewife was making 10,000 miles a year because she was driving to all the places to do her shopping. This has gone up and up and up. And I found operating in my life where I was then beginning to sweep out 30,000 miles and then I'm going to be 50,000 and now it's going to do well over 100,000 a year. And so that I didn't know this was coming. Nobody knew it was coming. This is the synergetic interaction of all these effects of evolutionary advance of the little man himself. So finally I got to where after 1958, I began to find myself leaving my cars literally at airports and not having a chance to go back to them. I was renting, paying space, so I finally had to get some agent to go and take it away and sell it for me. So now I rent my cars wherever I go to, and at first I, having owned 45 cars, I went through the smell of your own car and the knowing that how all the things that I fixed on it and so forth. When you did do, were the mechanic, and you really did have a better car than the other guy, because you really knew how to fix your car, and he didn't. That has some meaning. But I began to realize that the big motor business was operating in a way really very deleterious to our interests. I'm going to be able to give you a little insight into this, because I did get into producing 3 motor vehicles, and they look so attractive to the big automobile companies that the big automobile companies all thought about taking them on to produce them. So I had a great deal of contact with those automobile companies. The most important relationships were with Chrysler. There was the old Packard outfit, and there was a Wall Street group of Hayden Stone. Hayden Stone had owned Curtiss Wright Aeronautical, and they also owned the Studebaker automobiles at that time, the old Pierce Arrow. And the Hayden Stone group wanted to take on the Dymaxion car and make it the Curtiss Wright Dymaxion. So to me, they said the airplane world was stealing from the automobile world, and they thought they might as well have the automobile world steal a little from the airplane, so they're going to use the advanced know-how of the aeronautical world, produce the Curtiss Wright Dymaxion, and they were going to then make it the lead car for the Studebaker family, and would produce it, the Curtiss Wright Dymaxion, in the old what did I say? The Pierce Arrow factory in Buffalo, New York, beautiful factory. In the earliest days, Pierce Arrow, Packard, Ford, Cadillac, they produced all the parts of the car in their own factory. And gradually, World War I found a letting out of subcontracts to produce parts in a very big way. So that gradually automobile companies went into more and more of assembly of parts. And the actual fact is today that at the time of the great crash in the United States did socialize the big corporations. They then nominated certain businesses, I said to you, U.S. Steel. There was some prime contractors who they were going to keep alive, always be able to carry on their warfare, to get their weaponry to protect the country. So these prime contractors, were going to always be kept alive. Now the United States then, at the New Deal time, though it made Ford Motor Company a prime contractor and General Motors a prime contractor, the criteria of being a prime contractor in the automobile business was that the automobile company had to make its own cylinder blocks, had to make its own crankshaft, and its own camshaft. That's all it had to do to be a prime contractor. And they all still do that in order to remain prime contractor, but functionally all the other parts are produced elsewhere by parts manufacturers on enormous competitive bidding to the automobile companies and working in thousands of the cent differentials of their pricing. Just Pierce Arrow factory being suddenly available, because it had been one of the companies that made everything under the roof, didn't work anymore, and those kind of companies began to go out. The Walter Chrysler also was very deeply interested in the car. The Hayden Stone deal to produce the Dymaxion car, Curtiss Wright Dymaxion, fell through when the New Deal came in, because Curtiss Wright in producing its airplanes felt that it also had to have airports to fly them out of, that nobody would think of buying an airplane without an airport, therefore they had to produce some airports. So the Curtiss Wright Company really produced and owned all the well-known little airports around. They were pretty small airports for the kind of planes they had, but they were the airport owners. And it was under an agreement that the New Deal was going to buy their airports, and they were going to take the money that came from the New Deal for the airports, and they were going to put it into this Curtiss Wright Dymaxion car in Buffalo. Well, something happened between the Wall Street firm and the New Dealers that didn't work, so they canceled this, so they never went through that deal. But Walter Chrysler became deeply interested in the car. He thought about producing it. And he came out the year after I produced my first Dymaxion. He came out with his Airflow. And he wanted to look at my Dymaxion. He said, and incidentally, there was a New York automobile show that. The automobile show was of very great importance in those years. And the New York Automobile Show of 1934, still the old Grand Central Palace on Lexington Avenue, the Chrysler Company, then getting enormous preparation to confront the public with Airflow, with the word Airflow coming suddenly in, streamlining. They took the main position at the show. It was, just remember, this still very depth of depression, 34, you're just 2 years out of the New Deal presidency, just crossing even though he's elected in 32, 33, so 1 year out of the depth of the depression. And so not many people had much money to take on space. The Chrysler Company had taken this very prominent space, but the automobile show couldn't sell much space to others, so they had given me free and asked me to bring in my Dymaxion car as a feature for the show, but I wasn't paying anything. So Chrysler Company said they would not pay for this very prominent, the front position of the show, unless they threw my car out. The police commissioner of New York was very well impressed with my, he was, General Ryan had been a head of the New York division during World War I, and General Ryan liked my car very much, so he invited me to park my car in front of the Grand Central Station on the Palace on Lexington Avenue. So it really did steal the show, and Walter Chrysler asked me to bring it down to his place in Long Island. He wanted to look it over, and he said, "You have produced the car I wanted to. By the time my engineers, my sales department, my bankers, everybody in this enormous corporation got through things, it wasn't anything that I really liked at all. It wasn't what I thought I was going to get. It's been modified so many times." And he said, "You produced the exact car I wanted to produce." And he said, "In our big corporation, we have checks and balances so that a nut inventor can't be a good persuader and get the corporation to really sink itself in deeply in something that's not going to work." But he said, "You really have had the right mechanic experience." Walter Chrysler himself was a mechanic, and he very quickly found out I too was a mechanic. And he said, "You've had the right experience and the receptivity to really produce the car that needed to be produced. And you had the capability to produce it." So he used to ask me to take out his various members of the board of directors to really see what a good car should have been, what they had been talking about. Now, Walter Chrysler said, "Let us make a comparison since you have produced what I did want to produce, and you've done it as a little individual, and I produced mine as an enormous corporation with all the checks and balances we have." He said, "Let's look into what it cost you to produce your prototypes." I built three of them, and he looked into what it cost to produce his prototypes. And we found that in the corporation, it took three times as much time and four times as much money to produce our prototypes. But I came out with a faultless one, as far as he's concerned, and he came out with a compromised one. So that he was really deeply impressed with what the little individual can do. When I talk to you about trying to find out what individuals can do that corporations and great states can't do, it's the whole matter of that bureaucracy and the checks and balances of very great importance. Anyway, this gave me great intimacy with the automobile world. Now, why the automobile companies did not get into producing my car, and I'll show you, Hudson, all of them looked it over. Walter Chrysler finally turned up why they did not. Really very simple. At that time, for every new car sold, five old cars had to be sold. After the rate of the getting the man who had a rather poor car, you had to take in his car, and you had to sell it, of course. And so that they found that the following. In the automobile mass production of cars, the automobile producer can't own all the cars he's producing. Get up to something like a Chrysler company at a Dodge factory, say 5,000 cars in one assembly plant, other many assembly, just one plant turning out 5,000 a day, and they were, say, something over $1,000, so you got 1,000 times 5,000, and so that you got that's $50 million. It's a very, yes, about $50 million. The company can't own its own product. There's not enough capital possibly to do it. So what happened is the automobile inventors got going, Henry Ford and others, the opposite, who, when people wanted their cars, there was a great profit for a distributor of a car, and it was very worthwhile being a dealer. So the dealers, there's something called distributor, which is a state area, and there's a local dealer within it. So the distributor has secondary dealers. The distributorship of the automobiles had been a very profitable matter, so much so that Henry Ford and others were able to write in their contract that if you happen to have my distributorship, you have to guarantee to take so many cars a year. So and you're going to have to then, in the contract, agree that you're going to have to let me know weekly what kind of car you want. Your quota for this week, we say, is going to be 300. How many, what are those going to be? Open and touring cars, runabouts, what are they, and what color, and so forth. So the automobile distributor has to give a schedule, as so many station wagons and such a date is agreed on. The distributor must be at the end of the production line. His representatives must be there with papers, banking papers, to pay for the car as it comes off. And he goes through a testing and drives it away. But see, I've been struck today where the way he's going to ship. This is the only way then that the automobile mass production could occur. Then this meant that the local dealer, rather distributor, got his contract because he was a well-known businessman and a businessman who apparently, when he undertook to do something, could bring it off so that he risked some money and would make a profit, and everybody came out all right. So the distributor himself could not possibly put up the money to buy all these cars, so he went to the local bank. And the local bank knew him as a businessman who didn't bite off all that he could chew, so he would finance him. So it meant then that the local banks didn't own the money, it was the people's deposits. So what happened was that the people's deposits were, you and I didn't know it, our deposits are funding Detroit to produce cars. And our funds, our deposits are literally buying those cars, and they're held temporarily then in the paperwork by the bank, and they go on to dump it as quick as they can on some customer. But there's very, very, very high equity advantages of the bank has done such percentage the bank can't really lose. You're not really losing your money because his repayment capabilities and so forth are very, really very high, but almost unjust terms. Anyway, the banks then, Walter Chrysler found then, the banks own the automobiles. Then, furthermore, the salesman ought to be able to sell that car had to be agreed to take the car in. So then again, the distributor couldn't buy all those cars, so the banks bought them. So we found the banks, I mean, all the lots full of cars around that country here, your deposits own those, and you don't know it, but the bank managers were very eager to be sure they're getting rid of those. And so far, I've stopped now, he's done pretty well. And the equities they have, are such that they could market go fairly far off. But what Walter Chrysler discovered was that if you advance car number one, your best car, too fast, it deteriorates the value of your second-hand cars. It accelerates the deterioration, and the banks would not allow the automobile companies in Detroit to advance the models. They could be really quite superficial. What they did was to then make a superficial change in the body. And in the styling departments, all automobile companies are putting clay in the mudguards, making these a little more streamlined each year, and then just making them so the mudguards and everything outside looked different, but it's exactly the same chassis. There were gradually improvements of the better brake, in where the brake is. There was some engineering that did get better, but this is really very slow, and the changes were really superficial. So the banking equity was not in jeopardy. In other words, it was not a matter of the automobile companies wanting to produce the Maxim car, they just found they couldn't. Now, I tell all that to you because after World War II found all the enormous production capability of Detroit, wanting to get in on the enormous money of World War II, so that they had to agree to give up the automobile production as well as getting out the tax and everything else. But all the automobile companies then agreed one with the other, and they advertised it. Everybody wanted when they got back to have their nice old car. I want my real Franklin, nice new Franklin, but it's going to be just like that car. So they advertised that this is what G.I. Joe wanted, and so we'll keep everything for me. So they kept all their dies. Now, a new tooling of a car cost my figures, I haven't had this recently. In 1951, I know it cost Detroit about $70 million to retool a new car. So they don't like to spend that kind of money. At any rate, they agreed to keep their tools. World War I, technology advances incredible. It meant then when the war was over, Italy and the foreign people were not in this mass production, but were really producing cars, really one off still, were very, very advanced. And the American companies came in, got out all the old dyes, and they couldn't compete with the beautiful technology of the rest of the world. As a consequence, they found the distributors didn't like their automobile business anymore. The cars are not selling with the ease that they did. General Motors and Ford got enormous building programs where they got fancy new quarters for Cadillac and very continually upping the sales room, trying to make things look more schmaltzy and so forth. But the distributor found that he just having a very hard time to sell his cars because, meantime, labor rates are going up, everything going up. And the margin of 30 or 40% that the distributor had was really eaten up by everything, his rents and the works. He was going through a terrific headache and making no money. So that he said, I'm going to give up my dealership. And they realized he was a very good man. They didn't want to lose him. So what the automobile company started doing was designing a perfectly good car, but deliberately putting in inferior metal into this part or that part. It looked like just the way the part should look, and so it could really fool your eye all right, but it was designed to wear out in a hurry. So they guaranteed that all their dealers selling cars, that the customers would come back at least once a month and would pay so much. And what they did then was to advance the prices of the parts in the catalog, to where if you want to put together a car out of the parts catalog of Buick and so forth, it cost you 4 or 5 times what a Buick cost. So that the only way they were able to keep their dealers was this is where the words designed in obsolescence came from. That America then started really cheating itself, its big own business, deliberately fooling its own people. This is a fundamentally very unhealthy matter. But I'll come to the point now that I'm renting my cars, and I found that when I rent the car, because General Motors and Ford own their Avis and their Hertz and so forth, then they maintain the car, they don't put in the bad parts. So when I rent my car, I get a very superior car to anything I can buy, I assure you. And I can get a pretty new, almost a new car every time, and it's really very pleasant, and I can keep it as long as I want it. I go out for Christmas time in California with my family, I'll rent a car for a month. It's my car just as much as it ever was in my car. There's no kidding about it. So this is kidding myself about owning it. And so I simply see this way it's going to go. I find ownership becoming increasingly onerous. I have moved a number of times and just finding very valuable, lovely old things that our grandmothers and grandfathers gave us, stolen things. Then we begin to want to move from town to town and it costs you $25,000 and so forth. The ownership becoming increasingly onerous. And I find all the big corporations are really realizing that, so Chrysler and Ford really, they got to get in the renting business. And this is exactly what I said to you earlier. The only industries that are going to survive are going to be giving services. And they're going to be giving good services. they're going to be continually really improving the product, because the better the product, the more people use it. So they earn just on the frequency of giving good service. It gets into a very different kind of a drive from what it's been with it, trying to get you to buy something and leave it up to you to get rid of it. Now, I talked to you a lot about these things go off these drives, and I had a this is then relative all these things I'm saying to you to the talk I gave you the other night about monies and backings and world economics and what's on the books and so forth. So you really, as best I can, I want to get to feel and understand the kind of an accounting revolution that will come about. We go from the ownership over to service, we go from the just the ownership and blindly to know-how. And the understanding that the important part of wealth is the know-how part, that the material, just the rock by itself, is nothing. Now, was another aspect I left out talking to you about, because we came really to the end of time, and that was I pointed out to you that the building industry was the last of the one-off industries, where automobiles have gotten, vehicles have gotten into mass production, and your watches and your clocks and everything else is in mass production. And you could really get out a very great deal of capability for humanity at very low price that way. But the last and only in phase of man's activity that was not in that industrialized mass production world was the building world. Well, the building world, oh yes, we do. We mass produce nails and we mass produce bricks and so forth. But it wasn't then the parts were the kind. It was the assembly. And when you begin to assemble a building out and it's raining, no environment control, and that man's hands are freezing, I got to stop work with the wind. There's no way. You have to do things under controlled conditions. You have to really produce under the most optimal conditions. That's what we do with everything else. And right, at the time of, I point out to you, all the buildings of Italy, those beautiful castellos, done with slaves, didn't cost any money. You just put a whole lot of people to work and built your building. But when labor and humanity began to share equally and get some equal enjoyment of our economy, as labor is able to finally by developing its unions to force itself into such a position, then you really had to pay people properly. You couldn't afford the building, so that we have the building industry, as I said, was really obsolete at the time of the great crash, when then the banks took in these farms that really unwanted kind of living equipment, and we then began to rehabilitate the mortgages, and we, from there on, the government continues financing, or doing it by guaranteeing that, telling the bank it could go then and give mortgages on the buildings. And it was all simply because of a fundamental U.S. subsidy of the building industry. What I didn't tell you yesterday was then that we've gone on then in this enormous mortgaging, and the government taking over the fundamental risk of all the mortgages. At the time of the New Deal, the national debt was the largest it had ever been in history. It was $36 billion. It's really an amazing matter that we've come into World War I where national debt was approximately zero. Something would get into a billion once in a while, but get cleaned up. It was a very new matter to get into such big figures, and the great crash really occasioned it getting up to $36 billion. The things that paid it as it was trying to end it into between 1929 and a New Deal coming in 1933. At any rate, the national debt is now up to, and the interest on that $33 billion was, as I remember it, it was very, very low at the time, about 3.5%. And rate, the interest on it was somewhere in the magnitude of $1 billion a year. Interest had the government had to pay the banks. We've now gotten to where the national debt is approaching $600 billion. It's over half $1 trillion. We're paying these incredible usurious rates of interest, so that we're at a point now where the annual interest The government's having to pay the banks is greater than the national debt of the time they're dealing in. An incredible trickery has been done here, and out of that national debt, about $300 billion represents what the United States has had to go into debt in order to finance the building industry, which was absolutely obsolete when they took it over. That's what it cost to finance an obsolete industry for a third of a century. I assure you that the building that we've known, the architecture you've been in, the whole game is absolutely over. It's all stopped altogether. And if we do survive on our planet and we stop using our highest technology and so forth just to kill, going for the killing ray, and apply airspace technology and the physicists and so on, how do you really make life work to man's living ray? You get the chemists, the physicists really working on how to use the human waste. I said, no scientist ever been asked to look at the plumbing. I was able to really find that out. What an amazing thing. That when we really have science really looking at the living ray, then things are going to change very, very greatly. Please understand. And I know absolutely highly feasible today for us to fly a whole city into position. It's like bringing a whole fleet in the harbor. And one day you can fly a whole city into position and remove it tomorrow. Those are the kind of things that are going to be happening, so that when you see the kind of buildings we now have here are going to be, we're going to make very good mines, nice iron mines and so forth, good copper mines, etc. But they must be thought of that way. And so we're in a part where the United States is bankrupt. It is foreign indebtedness. It just, you can't touch it. And the American human beings, the money equities are down the game is still going on out there. And it's going to be a long time for people to really know that suddenly this is not going to work here, and then we're going to be very bad this time. But as I said, it's going to come on here really very silently. The big money honey monopoly, it has lost its out, and they're just not going to announce to you that they're all through, the money game is through. Never do. You man is simply going to have to find it out. Once you realize that it is important that I have been able to keep my position of being considered apolitical, that my whole strategy had been in artifacts and not in trying to reform the man, not to get into politics. Therefore, I find myself being trusted. I really find myself, it's amazing that I'm trusted by the Russians, and I find myself, when, for instance, just before Christmas, I was asked to speak to the State Department's Foreign Service School, a year's school of the top men who are going to represent the United States in the civil service, who will become an ambassador or something becoming, and have this year's school, and for me to talk the way I'm talking to you here, and Sonny Applewhite was with me, Sonny's 34 people, something like that, yeah. and for these kind of people to stand up and give you an ovation, it's very strange. But when I'm really saying the service is really all through, and they're giving an ovation still, so that. I want you to realize I'm not speaking as a subversive or something. I'm simply saying what I've had the experience to see. I'm just telling you what I've seen, this way I operate, and as you get to, and the people who are expert in any field say yes, that's so. Did I leave anything else out now? No, those are the things that I realized that I hadn't fully developed for you the other night, that I got pretty close to it. But I want you to really feel, when we come now, because my own function, which I expose you to as a grand strategy, is that of the design science. And what are the challenges of the design science? And they are, then, how do I arrange to get humanity, look out for life support, so that it really can prosper, really look out for that new young life, that it does not get the ill condition reflexes of yesterday, debilitating its perceptivity and its resourcefulness and curiosity and dismaying it. So we have that young world coming along, able to really quite fearlessly, spontaneously employ these principles of nature which we now learn enough about, where it is now, inasmuch as I now know and can see and really spell out the technical feasibility of looking out for all humanity, the highest standard living anybody's ever known, and do so for all the generations to come, and doing so on our energy income and not on our savings account, which the fossil fuels are. Now that I know that can be done, and therefore, as I said to you the other day, this minute, then I know that politics are obsolete, because they will only be founded on, it had to be you or me. They were theories of how to get on as you or me, like which is going to be the preferable me. That's what the bios of politics are about. I know that's obsolete. I know the war is obsolete. I know really approximately everything we've been engaged in is obsolete, the games. And here are all these brilliant human beings, and they really are brilliant all around the world. They're beautiful. But what are we all going to get to thinking about? So in the hours and days, the hours that I still have left with you, and I think we're down to possibly 12, 15 hours, something like that. It's not very much. I've got a whole lot I would like to cover. I have lots and lots more pictures and so forth, and I like to just show you a few of them to give you a feeling of the reality, because remember what I've said, I must deal in artifacts. I must not talk about the artifact until I've reduced it to practice. In other words, you just don't talk about bright ideas. Everybody has bright ideas. And anybody can talk about it. I got a great invention. Nothing at all. And you find thousands of people got that invention. And they're doing nothing about it. So the whole thing is, can you reduce it to practice? Does society really permit this thing? It's a very big test. And what I really learned out of reduction to practice has been by far the largest amount of my learning. So I think if I show you a few slides of things I've been involved with and so forth, you can understand why I had to have a better map projection. I had to see my world. I wanted to see what the shop looks like, what's the environment we're doing in look like. And I'd like to now show a few slides of and while I may seemingly bring in subjects I've talked to you about before, This we're looking at now, what I call a geoscope. I wanted to see the world a little better than just in my map. And I've just since been given a paper, incidentally, on a number of people historically that I did not know about until about a week ago when I started reading this paper. It's a beautiful paper. The number of people who had a feeling about how to get humanity to see their Earth in a little better way. And so the great world's fairs and the Paris Exposition, the time the Eiffel Tower, they were planning a big miniature Earth. I got into miniature Earth in quite a lot, and I think I told you a little about the one, for instance, we have at Southern Illinois University in Edwardsville. Have I talked about that? No. All right. But what you're looking at right this minute is a sphere, which is a miniature Earth, on the roof of the electrical engineering building at Cornell University, where in 1951 I had one of the architectural classes, and we went in for this project. And this beautiful structure was built. It was an 8-frequency geodesic, and it was built with very delicate wood slats. We can get down to, remember, you get to what's called a two by a half, but it really dresses out something very much less. It's these long, very nice, clear slats. And we made the structure out of those light, clear pine slats. They're painted blue. And being painted blue, they had very much a feeling of water, as you look at it there. And you could see through the thing, so it had sort of this transparency of the water. It had an extraordinarily water effect. Now, what we did, because I had my trigonometry very, very accurate, I was able to coordinate the mathematical coordinates, the latitude-longitude grid very accurately with my geodesic grid. And we found then, you're now used then to the icosahedron, it has 30 edges. And each edge of the icosahedron or tetrahedron, any of these structures, the omnitriangulated structures, the edge has what I call a domain. Edge has a domain where it owns up to the center of gravity of the two faces which it divides on the surface. So if you take these two centers of gravity, the two triangles adjacent, perpendicularly away from the edge, and join the ends of the edge together with those center of gravity, you get a diamond. And as there are, with the 30 edges of the icosahedron, there are also then 30 diamonds. Just look, for instance, at the octahedron. I said there's a domain of edges. Domains of edges then are up to the centers of gravity of the faces they divide. So there's an edge, and it divides this face from that face. So owns that this edge up, this center of gravity up to here. And this edge here owns up the center of gravity there. And each one owns up to, so if I connect the centers of gravity of the octahedron and its vertex, you get a center of 12 diamonds. And those 12 diamonds will be the rhombic dodecahedron. If you extend the center of gravity outward a little, this becomes that. So that the domains of vertexes are also then connecting the centers of gravity between the adjacent faces in a circle around it. That's where you get the dodecahedron and so forth. Those are domains of vertexes. So the dodecahedron is the domains of the vertexes of the icosahedron. So I want you to understand what we mean by these special characteristics of the, so the domain of the face is the face itself. Now, I had then, with the Cornell dome, we had the 30 diamonds that coincided then with the, which I had the mathematical coordination with the latitude-longitude grid of our Earth. And we broke up our project into these, more than that. Each of the 30 diamonds, being a diamond is more or less, it's called a parallelogram if it's in the flap. You can then make a perpendicular line in it. Here's a diamond face, so I make a line going like that. It's parallel to the two edges of it that make it then a thin, what we call a raft, R-A-F-T. So we had 60 rafts. And we then had the, what we did was to lay down, took pieces of large wrapping paper, the size of it, one of these diamonds of the icosahedron, the raft. And we put on the geographical coordinates, latitude, longitude, and then plotted the land, the edges of the land. We then, each there were 60 students, so they each had one of these rafts, and then the each one then took a chicken wire mesh. It was a half-inch chicken wire mesh. And they rolled that out flat on the drafting boards, and they then laced it to the wrapping paper so that they could then cut the chicken net to conform exactly the same shape, and it's fastened to the paper, and we have then the outlines of the land on the paper below it. If it's in the middle of the Pacific Ocean, it may not be in the land, so there's no lines. Then we took bronze fly screen, a beautifully fresh bronze fly screen, and it had some kind of plastic treatment, so it kept its shininess, and we cut out the continental areas for that particular piece of the chart and sewed it onto to the chicken wire. Then when we made our dome of these slats and so forth, there were diamond areas identified, and the students were able then to take their raft of chicken wire with its bronze screen corresponding to the land and fasten it into place on the dome. And when they did so, then finally the whole surface of the Earth is represented by, and so that where there's just a chicken mesh and blue, come back to then you see the blue painted structure, but the chicken mesh you can't see, it's invisible to you from the distance, and the bronze screen you can see, the sun is reflecting from it. So the bronze screen then gave the exact continental outline. What you're looking at in this picture is the upper upper left middle would be the Bering Straits. You're seeing Alaska towards you here, and we're looking the northern part of Siberia, and you can see that. Now, I think actually the picture is reversed, I'm sorry to say. And the upper right hand there, sort of floating bronze, that is Greenland. Is back around the wrong way. It'll be good if they do turn it, and then we'll be able to talk about it a little more intelligently. And then what we did with our sphere, now you can really see, you can see the Greenland, and you can see the Alaska, and it begins to make sense. You can see Kamchatka, there's a peninsula coming down there, and you can see Japan over the right-hand side, etc. Now, strangely, if you do look at those photographs coming in to our planet from the moon, so whether you see through cloud cover, strange enough, we do get this kind of a blue transparency, and we get the bronze-like color for the land. It seemed to be a strangely good representation, and seen from a distance. May I have the next picture? Because in the next picture from this, you see it began to look more and more like our planet, as it does as you come in and out of space. I'm going to now keep that picture a little bit, because it gives you the next thing we did. With our miniature Earth now, we mounted it up in the roof on tripods at considerable height, and we oriented the sphere in such a way that its axis, its North Pole-South axis, was exactly parallel to the real Earth's axis. And then we rotated the sphere around its North Pole-South axis so that Ithaca, where Cornell is in New York, was in zenith. So the way our big planet Earth is oriented in the heavens, Ithaca is in this direction, and then the little miniature. So the little one was mimicking the exact posture of the big Earth in the universe. The distance to the nearest star being 92 million miles away and so forth, and even from any other star group than the sun, if you could ever see such a little light as our Earth reflecting the sun's light, you would not have, for any distance apart, you would never know whether you were looking at a little, my miniature Earth or the big one, because their centers are only 4,000 miles apart. And the distance of 4,000 miles apart is absolutely undetectable. So the little Earth is exactly the same attitude, and if something happens to the big Earth, it's fine. It has the same attitude in the heavens. Now, this is what happens incidentally if you have a boat on the davits of the Queen Mary. And the boat on the davits is parallel to the Queen Mary's keel. And so whichever way the Queen Mary heads, the little boat heads. And the big Queen Mary is tipping, the little boat is tipping. In fact, from inside the little boat, and observing just what the little boat does, you know exactly what the Queen Mary is doing, in relation to the heavens and stars and compass and everything. So that I want you to realize it became really a true miniature Earth. And what you saw, we had this tripod, I said, and the tripod legs came up through the Indian Ocean. Happened to be very convenient when it came that way, so it didn't go through any of the continents. And we could go up a ladder on the tripod, and there was a platform, and the center of the tripod is the exact center of the Earth, offset by a little distance. Because so you put your chin on the top of the tripod, your eye was at the center of the sphere. So what you saw with your chin on the tripod was exactly what you'd seen if you had took an elevator down the center of the Earth from Ithaca, always keeping Ithaca above you here, and what you look out at, if you had X-ray eyes, any star in zenith over any continent would be there. So the students became fascinated by that, because inside there we could see all the stars, you see. It was really lovely. Didn't block them at all. Even through the fly screen, no trouble at all. So here's, for instance, at the first night it happened, the Big Dip was over the North American continent. And they were able to get on the telephone and check with that star's in zenith over that point. It was an absolutely true planetarium. Say, the offset of the star, no error whatsoever in this 4,000 mile offset from the center. you don't get really any difference as you're going around the sun orbiting the Earth. Very little displacement difference, let alone that much of a difference. So that we're making 60,000 miles an hour around the sun, so not often, not long before you get that kind of differential very fast. Now, so I want you to understand, this is miniature Earth, and for the first time in history, I think, grown-ups in there began, we spent a luckily beautiful night the first night we finished it. It was a lovely May evening. And as you're in there, first place on the roof, you could come down about on the, what you're looking at the roof side nearest you, this side of the sphere, the north was in the other direction. So if you looked up through, looked through the south pole of the miniature Earth, and move yourself to the south pole is exactly on the north pole of the miniature Earth, then there was a pole star right there. Just lovely, lovely. And you could see right to see all that. So inside it, when you stood really looking, facing north on the platform, which we made arrangements very easy for you to do, then you realize that the pole star is staying right there, and you began to realize that the nearer you came to your left and right near the equator, the more rapidly the wires were passing the stars. So he began to really feel the rotation at the, this first time, suddenly began to really realize our Earth was evolving. You became so absolutely convinced of his right attitude that there was somebody evolving in the show here. On that axis, no, polar axis, you really felt it. The kids stayed there all night, and the next day we began even, it was fascinating that the chicken mesh wire, and that was rather even the little bronze wire, such that a star, just the refraction of light just bending around the wire, you really could feel these things and the glisteningness. It was a very, very impressive experience. So this then had to do with getting you and I hooked up with the universe. I built quite a number of these sets. The idea was to get to bigger and bigger ones, and from Cornell I went to the University of Minnesota, where we undertook to do the 200-footer. We never did get it finished. I told you about doing that polyester fiberglass. And then I went on to Princeton, and Princeton decided we would really, really lick this business. And we worked for 3 years on the project at Minnesota, and then three successive years at Princeton. And got to where it needed quite a lot of money. And we found that we could do all the, instead of having to use, we'd have just electric lights on the sphere. And many, many, many of them, and they would simply illuminate, and we found we didn't even have to draw the outlines, because we could then have a computer light the lights to outline anything you wanted, any attitude you wanted, so forth. Realize that back of the UN building in New York, in the East River, is what used to be Blackwell's Island, and then it became Welfare Island, and it had all kinds of insane asylums and city prisons on it. Gradually those were moved away. They built a new island of refuge up there, further towards the south, and all those things up there. Today, it's now been renamed Roosevelt Island. And right south of Blackwell's Ledge, Blackwell's Island is Blackwell's Ledge, with bell buoys and so forth, a whole group of rocks in the water. And they're right actually out to the east of the United Nations building. And what I wanted to do was to build them a miniature Earth mounted from those rocks, having mass, and mounted in cables. It would weigh so very little, the cables would be really invisible and seem to be floating out there. It looked like a miniature Earth that's come in close to our Earth here. And at the United Nations building, we made it so it's going to be 200 feet in diameter, be mounted 200 feet above the water, so it'd be the height, that'd be 400 feet, be the height of the United Nations building. So it would be a miniature Earth really out confronting the representatives of the world. And we wanted to have on it, actuating everything that's going on, where there was all the bonfires are, all those fires must be burning, and so we really continually have the world looking at itself and looking at the consequences and getting the different kind of viewpoints that you can get. So At one time, this looked like it would be around $10 million, and then I'm sure today it costs a good deal more, but it was a feasible sum. Now, the 200-foot diameter was because the height at which the Air Force started flying mosaics of the world before we got the satellites, the lowest area, the height that it flew from, and making aerial mosaics of Europe and Germany and so forth, whatever they might be, was at a height where if you took the 35-millimeter photograph made by them, and you put 35-millimeter photographs together edge to edge, you'd make a 200-foot sphere. You could take a direct photograph, and in those photographs, you could make out, you can see all the streets and everything, you can see individual humans' houses, but you can't see the humans. But you can really see your home. You know that's your home, just as clear as can be. You pick it out. So that I wanted some way in which we had a scale where human beings could really feel themselves on the earth. Even though they couldn't quite see themselves, they'd really feel, these are my works, and the house is part of me, so that was a scale. Now, we have built one for the religious center at Southern Illinois University, Edwardsville campus. That's a 50-footer. And the different religions, or the leaders of different religions, needed to have something on campus, and they pooled their monies together and had this religious center built. And it really does what we said, you go in to go out to the universe. and you go in to go, and you get out of the universe in a hurry. So you go in to go out. Now, and that is, you're looking at the religious center at Edwardsville right now, that picture. Now, I'm going to go through a number of pictures, thinking about things in a geoscopish kind of way. I give this name geoscope, and I tried miniature earth, had different kinds of ways of talking about it. Next picture, please. We're back then to Cornell. Incidentally, this is the way it looked on the campus, and I'm sorry to say that the next four Halloween students from other parts of the university, this sphere looked very attractive to them, and somehow the scale of the building got on top, and they wanted to get down and roll it around the campus for Halloween to do, but they put it over the edge and let it drop and smashed it. These sad things do happen when development projects. It was a very, very rich experience. Next picture. This is in London. A number of the universities now have been making my geodesics, but doing the sphere in transparency. So it's really quite easy to make quite a large sphere transparent. But you have your air breathing problems and so forth. Next picture. That is another one of those. Next picture. I'll just give you then again, some you already looked at, where the people are on our planet. Next picture. And the ill design of the Mercator. Next picture. I'm just going really quite fast. The water ocean world, the British Empire. Next picture. And now the air ocean world, where going from east west to abrupt north south, and integrated the whole world, instead of being all divided. And Canada coming in because they had the greatest proximity to China and Russia and so forth. There is the Edwardsville campus of Southern Illinois University happens to have running through the grounds the 90th meridian of our Earth, 90 west. As you know, the meridians, you add the two amounts of the east and the west, and they must make up to 180 degrees. And so the 90 is the only one where the 90 east and 90 west are the same, something like a 45 degree, 45, nice isosceles right triangle. So 90 west, and the Edwardsville campus, I got the chancellor of the university to allow me to build our building exactly on the 90th meridian. So the 90th meridian runs right through, is the axis, our north south axis, right? Actually greatest surveyor accuracy. So we have a strip running out from the building of the 90th meridian. Now that 90th meridian runs north and gets in, goes through very strategic, but it comes down through Bangladesh, kind of comes right through the center of population, the most highly concentrated of all of humanity. And you find that the 90th meridian really becomes a highway. Then if you want to get one meridian nearest to most people, it would be it. And it is that north and south one. Next picture, please. Now we're looking at the world as if you lived in South Africa. I spoke to you about the couriers coming from Australia to Churchill during World War II, and I put the pieces together with Australia at the center. I said, "Why, that's the way the world map. That's the way the world is. Why don't people make maps that way?" So this one is South Africa's viewpoint. Next picture. This is a North Pole viewpoint. Yes. Next picture. And this is a United States viewpoint. Next picture. And here we have India's viewpoint. Next picture. And this is the equatorial stretch out. You can go take on my map piece and go right around the equator that way. Next picture. This is going, making an equator of the, this is the path I gave you of the going around the world where you don't touch any continents. But it is a path of where the all the astronauts, all our vehicles went off on this path every time. Next picture. Now, I'm going to show you something here quite interesting, this over the north flying. Having become, way back in 1927, when I started my work, I really committed myself very much to an over the pole north world. And in, as World War II was coming on, I told you I used to be on the science technology consultant to the staff of Fortune magazine. Also, I was a main advisor to Life magazine. And Life magazine asked me, after I left Time Incorporated, if I would come in as consultant. And they were planning, they wanted to get up an issue. They were reporting World War II in a very big way, and it had been joined by the Germans and the English and so forth. The United States was not quite in yet. This was before Pearl Harbor. The Life staff asked me if I would get up a grand strategy of the best way to lick Hitler. As you know, Hitler was then rushing, pushing everybody in the water. And he was in central England there and pushing people to the water and into the water. And they asked me if I could develop a grand strategy for the United States. Later on, I learned the grand strategy that was taken on by the United States was Churchill's grand strategy. He called it the soft belly. He had the Americans come in to go to South America and then across to North Africa, and then come in under the soft belly to Sicily and Italy, that this is the weakest part, and instead of trying to go across the channel. Later on, they do go to the channel, but not until they weaken things very much from the south. At any rate, they asked me if I could develop a grand strategy which would lick Hitler. And so I proposed going immediately over the Arctic and flying all the logistics, not doing ships at sea, but getting into towing, have airplanes that were towing, tug airplanes that were pulling gliders, which was great, they was used a great deal during the war. But enormous gliders, the gliders were to be designed in such a way as to be actually usable as part of buildings and so forth after they landed. I worked out the complete logistics. They were great plywood cylinders, and they had a standard nose that would go on them, they had a standard tail that went on them, and you had a standard wing section went on them, and they just had to be gliders to be towed. And I had friends in the Air Force who were working on towed gliders, so that I found that a practical thought. And I was going to use then the wing sections became parts of the roof section, and the cylinders, after they emptied all the cargoes out of them, became columns for assembly, for factories, assembly buildings and so forth. And anyway, I proposed coming in and joining up with Russia and pushing Germany into the water, because you had to get behind it. And anyway, the Life staff got very excited by this, and they spent a month or two working with me, and they got up, so we finally published it in Life. And this is a piece. Next picture, and then that was the cover of Life, that where that came out. Next picture. Then this is a letter which you can't read, written to me by the senior editor who did all the war things of Life at that time, telling me, certifying about this being my strategy, because all the meetings were held at his house, and that because something very, very interesting happened. They didn't put my name on the story. After that I went to Washington. I became head mechanical engineer of the Board of Economic Warfare. There was a man named Gary Underhill who was the great strategic arms man, advisor on Life magazine. He'd grown up in the Army, United States Army, son of a general, and he knew all the clothing, you know, trappings of every division of any of the German Army, and he incredibly well informed. He'd been taken to Washington then as head of one of the departments, in, I think it was G2 or something like that. One day in Washington, he asked me to come have lunch with him, and he gave me a copy of Wehrmacht. Wehrmacht was the German military of their great military magazine, and they published in the format of Life, more or less copying it. But it was the only real big news that the armed forces of Germany had was the Wehrmacht. And in this copy of the Wehrmacht, they had a reproduction of the Life article. And the German general said this is the only way we could be licked, but he said the Americans are too naive to do it. So it was really very interesting to have such a document, and so the head of G2 gave me the Wehrmacht magazine to take home, and I have it, and the boys are getting ready for this show, photograph the old Wehrmacht magazine there. But I just do that to show you how you really can, by being a comprehensivist, get to really see things. So the things I've been saying to you about where we are in economics at the moment, I realize that I have had insights many times of what way things are really stacking up. And I hope this helped to just give you some confidence in things I'm saying. Next picture. This is just more of the Wehrmacht story. Go through it quite fast. There, the towing the gliders. Next picture. How you take off with them and so forth. We went into really absolute detail about this, and then the other experts that Life took on were able to really get into all the armaments, everything would be necessary for the proper attack. Next picture. Keep right on, please, these pictures. We can get through it fairly fast. This is the cover of Wehrmacht that their statement came out on. This would be it was just about the time my map came out in Life. It was in the winter of 43, early in the winter of 43. Next picture, please. That's the reproduction in Wehrmacht. Next picture. Now here I'm showing you something else, because I've been talking about tensegrity, and I explained to you about pneumatics, and that the tensegrities really are then visible. The compression members in the tensegrity are visible paired molecules of gases going in two directions. And this is now a geodesic dome made in the following way. You're used to pneumatic buildings. We have the whole thing filled with air. But here we don't do that. We have two geodesic domes, one about 6 inches greater radius than the other. And all the pattern is done very neatly in the right dimensions. And one is sewn inside the other, and there are webs on the triangular lines, web between the two. Then we just let air into this between, so that the atmosphere makes the inner one, as I said, with the metal one, pushes it outwardly, and they just stay absolutely by themselves. You don't need to have air inside the whole dome, you don't have to have it inside the wall, provided because we know how the molecules operate, because they go in the Dymaxion pattern. So here's one that we've made. Could you remove me from the picture? But I have it supine, and we made them with compressed air bottles, so that they could be dropped by helicopter or airplanes. These were all dropped by airplanes over the Arctic. And there are great enormous islands of ice that float over the Arctic. And scientific teams were put onto those since World War II, and this is what they lived in. This made a beautiful dome, and they had a sponge rubber floor about 6 inches deep, with good insulation against the ice. I got many, many letters from scientists living in those domes. And next picture, it just popped open. It just touched the thing, and the thing gives it shape right like that. And you can see then your triangulation, and you can see how the webbing is done. Next picture. There's a man standing on top of it, just a rigid steel. Now, I saw that you could go even further than that we could cut out the webs of the triangles, because it was only the triangular forms, because that's where the pattern of the molecules go in. Next picture. So here is then a geodesic made where you only have a plenary chamber of the tubes themselves. And this is the shape it takes. This pops, it always automatically comes like that. I want to give you more and more confidence in experiencing with me. I say the reduction to practice and you'll really learn whether your theories are right or wrong. So I've given every kind of a test I can, and it's proven up absolutely superbly. Pneumatics, it has to. This is the shape it's going to want us to take. It takes it. Next picture. Now, here I also, I've talked to you about delivering whole cities by air. In the 1927, when I started in on thinking about dwelling machines for human beings and mass production dwelling machines to live in, and environment controls, I then said, you can't assemble things and move them over the highways, because the railroad bridges automatically would make like a sausage machine and give it a shape. That's exactly why the trailers are the shape they are. They're not only 8 inches, eight feet wide and such a height. So they're extruded by the bridges. And I said, I've got to have some way of delivering the dwelling facilities, the environmental controls, by air to be transcendental to any bridges, anything like that. So that I got into them. Assumed right from the outset the air delivery of buildings, and I assumed right from the outset that I must meet the most formidable conditions. So my first thoughts actually were of delivering a 10-deck building, which would be used by, I remember I was in Navy, and this, I'm doing my thinking the year of the Lindbergh flight, and I'd come out of thinking about the Navy strategy to getting across the ocean and be stepping stones. You'd go to several islands. You wouldn't try to do it all in one piece. You'd like to make it a little safer. And they had then, I said you could fly over the Arctic because of the great eastern here, their water spaces that open up. So I planned a building for a maintenance crew, aeronautical maintenance crew, who would live in the Arctic, and we'd have then stepping stone flights over the Arctic, and be able to take care of it. But it had to be a building then was so absolutely complete that people just moved in. They didn't have to have any time. They don't freeze to death putting it up and so forth. So I went into the study of the... This picture is really sad because in the upper right-hand corner there is, and it should be on the left here, there's a Zeppelin. I had gotten then into what weight was necessary using a spine and tensegrity forms of tension webbing and so forth to make a 10-deck building. What weight could I really get down to? And I found that to do all the things I really needed to do. And I got down to a weight which I found the year 1927, called the scantlings of the design data on the Graf Zeppelin, which was about to be built in Germany, were given, and what she could carry, what a useful carrying load would be. And I found my 10-deck building could be carried by the Graf Zeppelin. Therefore, next, go back to that picture again, if you don't mind, please. I had then this is a cartoon, and in the upper left-hand corner cartoon, I had the Zeppelin with the building, 10-deck buildings, suspended horizontally below the Zeppelin. It looks just like a very large cabin on the Zeppelin. And the Zeppelin drops a bomb to make a crater. And then they lower the building down into the crater hole. You can see the crater hole in the middle top picture. And they go down and they fill it in again, planting it like a tree. And it had all of its integral sewage disposal and everything, and the thing went down the bottom there. Anyway, I found it was, I knew I was not going to be alone with the Graf Zeppelin and so forth, but I knew that I was actually working within logistical limits, that it was a feasible matter to talk about delivering a 10-deck building by air. And I said, by giving myself the worst condition you could possibly have, the North Pole, this would be the test. I've got to have some limit conditions. And there'd be no building department at the North Pole to say you can't do it. It's very interesting, but the first real use of my geodesic domes was exactly that. It got to be the ray domes for the defense early warning system of the northern end of Thule and so forth. But nothing else would work, right? There is your 10-deck building, and the 10-deck building, it's done with, you see all this wire wire work and had pneumatic floor triangles and so forth. It had, like ships, built-in booms. The upper right-hand side, you see, there is an enormous aerial. There's also a wind, a vertical windmill of the Flettner type, and there are built-in arms, like the booms on ships for loading. And if you remove my figure from the picture a minute and look at the lower left-hand corner, and you see a bathroom being hoisted on a cable by the boom to be brought into the building. That is, you bring everything big in the building from outside, and you just open the building on the side to swing things in instead of trying to bring things through central elevators, which is really a very poor way to do. But if you load it the way you can, a ship just swing the sides of the buildings open, swing big things in, and close them up again, lock them up. Anyway, this is the way this whole thing was designed, and I want you to see that it did then have, right from the outset, integral use of wind power, and it had its tank in the base had all plans for using the human waste and so forth, the energies that were in there, because as of that time, it had already been proven that the chemical engineering section of the farm engineering of University of Illinois at Urbana, that the amount of methane gas in the human family waste of farm family would be enough actual of energy to run the farm machinery at the time. So that, incidentally, one little man took them seriously and went and developed an automobile in 1929, and the UN, I went to a meeting at the UN last year, they asked me to come down there, and this little man has been running his automobile on the methane gas from the family ever since 1929. He was no trouble at all. And right, once you get the early 1927 plans for the Dymaxion house and buildings, once you understand what is in there, you had to be totally responsible for all the needs of the human beings are going to be in there, and you had to be able to deliver and take away. Next picture. I said that because this picture and the one picture before, could you go back one picture of the airlift? In 1954, which is quite a long time after 1927, there's one picture before that one in the airlift group, where the United States Marine Corps, the head of the aviation logistics, had been found that the United States Marines and the Army and so forth, they had really no proper air deliverable environment controls. And they'd given out contracts to General Motors and given out some large number of contracts, I think some like 20 or 30 large contracts, two-year contracts, somebody developed air deliverable environment controls and didn't find it. And then suddenly, as Colonel Lane, who's head of the aviation logistics of the Marine Corps, found that I didn't have a geodesic dome, and they went into very, very thorough studies of them. This particular one, this is at a place, Orphans Hill in Raleigh, North Carolina. We had, it's 1954, and we had the first lift of my dome. And this is the first time I saw one of my buildings now really, really being practically taken somewhere. And the next picture of it, please. In the next one, we skipped one. We flew it at 60 knots. And so 60 knots where the hurricane begins, so it was a great test of just the hurricane stability of my building. And then we got into the one you just shown. Could I have that next picture back, the picture you just ran in again? There's another Marine Corps flying an open frame building. Now that's the very first in the Orphans Hill lift. Then came one moving at 60 knots to the same dome. But I had to also do my first calculation how you apply the sling to know how much stress it would be, the distribution of stresses. Next picture, please. It is the open, there we are. Now this is a much later phase of the dome being flown from Quantico, Virginia, the Marine Corps headquarters. And this dome was made out of magnesium tubing, and the Marines, a group of Marines could assemble, they assembled in 135 man minutes. And it was really quite a sight to see this thing go together. This is a large dome. This is a 50 footer. And so in the 50 footer you had about 2,000 square feet floor space. It was comfortable for a really large cover, all kinds of activities and the small planes. These then were flown, they began then flying these from the aircraft carriers. And it was quite a sight to see them come up on they'd assemble down the lower deck and came up in the elevator, and then the helicopter take off and fly off the mainland. And they see the skins flapping, they always flew them more than 60 knots. And the helicopter pilots found they behaved beautifully. There was no yawing around. They actually really very steady, really steady tail. Took a most comfortable aeronautical position. Next picture. So I just wanted to go back then. The idea of what I had thought could be done, air delivery buildings, for the first time was done in 54, and then began to use bigger and bigger buildings by air. But during World War II in Washington, when I was on the Board of Economic Warfare, I also, as I said, head mechanical engineer, but I also was on an interagency committee of different agencies of the government, with other foreign governments with allies. And I was on a committee of alternate resources. If something was not available, how would you solve the problem with other resources? And at those meetings, the chairman knew me well, but he would always, when he saw me come in, he'd always say, "Please don't ruin our meeting with those houses by air, please." and that was 43. And then by 54, 11 years later, I saw the Marine Corps really flying them. If the Marines were suddenly starved on their budget, but they had plans to really get enormous numbers of these things. The ones they did have, they were on typhoons and Okinawa and so forth. They were the only things that stood up time and again. They were very, very stable. Next picture. The next picture. I just ran those because I want to show. You have to try that. This is a picture of a Piasecki carrying a dome for the Ford Motor Company of 110 feet in diameter. That is, it's 10,000 square feet of floor space. And that was that dome they carried around. They brought it in all kinds of shows. And finally, that dome went to Seattle and became the Ford Motor Company exhibition dome at the Seattle World's Fair. And this then told me I could really. Now we're talking about, again, quite a number of years ago, by then we were able to deliver 10,000 square feet. The curve of increase of capability, because since then we've had Vietnam War, and the development of helicopters has just been phenomenal. We're at a point now where it really is truly feasible for us to deliver, I'm going to be able to deliver really stadium covers in a day. We're in that magnitude. In other words, houses, buildings by air, it could not be more practical. So, think about your architecture, be sure to be thinking about houses by air, buildings by air, that's where it's going to go, and we're going to really manufacture them in the aircraft plants. About immediately after World War II, big aircraft companies trying to find peacetime business before we started giving the aircraft companies a round of jets. They didn't know jets were coming. They were looking for business, and the Lockheed Company got into what they called General Panels Company. And that was Conrad Wachsman was the architect, and Gropius at Harvard designed General Panels, and they found they were simply producing units to go into the tailor-made buildings, and that the people who were designing the buildings themselves didn't know what they're doing. They were really making parts for something so inefficient that just was not a good business. About it was about 6 years ago, I was having a meeting with the chairman of the board and the chief, the vice president in charge of scientific research of Lockheed at Burbank, California. And they talked about their ventures in the General Panel, how that was the wrong thing, and that they had, however, they knew all about my house. They could not really accredit it. The Beech aircraft had developed a very good prototype. Lockheed didn't think it was going to happen. But Lockheed said to me that their chief, the vice president in charge of scientific research there. They were now at a point where they were on the actual drawing boards, and most seriously, they were considering the fact that there was a limit to continually building longer and longer runways of airports for bigger and bigger ships taking off horizontally. You're going to have to get to the vertical. And the English had already licked the vertical takeoff. So Lockheed was really planning its future on the vertical takeoff. So it was the only way to carry on. And it might get to the point where you really had vertical tugs, so both for your earliest takeoff and then going to get acceleration ready to take on the horizontal form of the flight. Anyway, they had their ways of solving those problems, and so they then were no longer limited to the size of runways. They also then cited to me a law that I would cite to you, that every time you double linear dimensions, you increase the volume, the payload by 8, and I have only four times my surface, so the driving the friction of the skin of the ship of the sea or the ship of the sky, that friction is the fourfold, and the payload is 8. So every time you double the size, you have twice the advantage and delivery of the payload. So the bigger and bigger the ship, the more worthwhile. But the longer, bigger and bigger ships, and the longer the runway. So they said we'd have to go, we want to get in really big ships, we're going to have to go into VTOL. So they were getting into a whole new, they had drawing boards and engineering, very complete and serious studies going on for a long time of that era of the vertical takeoff and the really big ship. They were designing and getting into ships, designing them up to 10,000 passengers. And when they got into that kind of a size, they said, suddenly, the relative size of apparatus for your living and so forth to the totality, synergetics of the big buildings continually improves in such a way that they said it suddenly would be absolutely practical, they could see, for the aircraft industry to be really in the building business, because it'd be highly feasible to build very large skyscrapers in the aircraft plant horizontally, come out horizontally, fly horizontally, and then upend at the site. So that they said that they now, for the first time, this was 6 years ago, accredited my, they could really prove it in the computer and so forth, be terribly worthwhile for the aircraft industry to actually get into the building world. This one I'm talking to you about delivering whole cities by air, if you understand, this is within the considered feasibility of the serious operators of the aircraft industry today. I know it's highly feasible to deliver whole domes because I get the 10,000 square feet floor space, which we were doing back at the time the CL was four there. I can give you very, very large domes. I gave you yesterday the energy efficiency that goes up every time you do it. So I've gotten into studies of a whole community under one single dome, where you live in the garden and it's not going to rain on you, and we can conserve all the rain, going to catch it all in the gutter, so you have your water and we don't have to go down the storm sewers, you're going to conserve it. And things really work out very, very economically, very well. You get what I call the Old Man River project. I want to come back to sort of the larger philosophy in relation to what I've been talking about, these 10-deck buildings and the air delivering of the buildings and so forth. Because it was 1927, I went to 17 years before I had the first actual witness of an air delivery, and then I saw it really did become a very practical matter, and I'm quite confident we're going to see it in a very, very big way. But the point is, it gets to be, I had to assume about a half century, that'd be 50 years before it might begin to have real, true relevance in the economics of man. I plotted many curves on, would give me some clue as to how long you would have to wait for various things, and what I used as most important was the rate of increase of tensile strengths in various metals, particularly getting into the aluminum alloys and the non-ferrous, which were at a very low order of strength when I first started and have gone up to extraordinary strengths. I also had to assume that in 1927, the largest clear plastic we had was a watch crystal. And it was celluloid, and it was not a watertight at all, and it got yellow very rapidly and scratched very badly. And this is simply what they made celluloid dolls and things like that, and it was highly inflammable. it was not until, well, in 1927 I started these things. That's really all I had to go. They had, at that time, poker chips, which were opaque, made out of casein or from milk. But there are great indications of developments in the plastics, and so I made a working assumption that I would come eventually to clear material that you could see through that would not be glass, would be lighter than glass, and would be almost as scratch-proof as glass and so forth.